Item number 347, outside the order of precedence, standing in the name of Ms. Hurst, relating to animal fur clothing.
Last week it was announced that Queen Elizabeth II has made the decision to eliminate cruel animal fur from her wardrobe and opt for humane faux fur alternatives. The Queen's senior dresser, Angela Kelly, confirmed that as of this year, our head of state has moved away from animal fur, much to the delight of both the Australian and the British public, the majority of who are disgusted by the cruel infliction on animals for the sake of human vanity. Over 50 million animals suffer and die as victims of the international fur trade. This includes kangaroos killed here in New South Wales and exported to regions including Europe, Asia and the USA. And not only do our laws currently condone the killing of innocent sentient animals for this barbaric trade, but we continue to support this cruel industry by allowing animal fur, including that from bears, possums, rabbits and raccoons, to be imported and sold within our state. Domestic animals, including cats and dogs, are also not exempt from this cruel industry. While Australia has banned the importation of cat and dog fur, international investigations have shown that cat and dog fur is frequently mislabeled and sold as fox, rabbit, or mink. Not that the species really matters, because the suffering is the same. Tolerating this grotesque industry is allowing this savagery to go ahead. It is clear the Queen and the extended royal family recognises this. The Duchess of Sussex, Meghan Markle, also chooses not to wear real fur for ethical reasons. I assume they know the brutal savagery any support for this industry is condoning. 85% of the fur industry skins come from animals raised in tiny cages. Animals are deprived of any form of quality of life and the ability to carry out their natural behaviours. As the majority of animals slaughtered for their fur are solitary, facing a life cramped in a cage with numerous other animals is incredibly stressful. Their suffering and frustration often leads many of these gentle animals to self-mutilate, biting at their own tails or gnawing at their own limbs. Following months of suffering in these horrific conditions, these traumatised animals are then killed by anal electrocution, gassed, breaking their necks or skinning them alive. Inhumane and often ineffective methods designed to avoid damaging their fur. For the 15% of animals slaughtered in the wild for their fur, the story's not any better. These wild animals are trapped by body gripping traps, steel jaw leg hold traps, and wire neck snares. Devices that inflict agonizing, prolonged pain and are often not designed to kill. Instead, allowing for a human to slaughter the distressed animal once they arrive at the scene. Allowing our state, via the continued allowance to sell fur, supports this barbaric, disgraceful industry, and everyone here in this house today should be horrified. There is no reason for New South Wales to participate in this extreme animal cruelty. With the variety of fashionable, humane alternatives now endorsed by the Queen, giving our support to this horrific industry is unconscionable. As stated by the United Kingdom's Humane Society, fur is firmly out of fashion, and it is. Everyone from the Queen to the community here in New South Wales knows that we don't need to abuse and kill animals in order to look luxurious. It is on this basis that I move that this House congratulates Queen Elizabeth II for removing cruel animal fur from her wardrobe and endorses comments made by the United Kingdom's Humane Society, affirming that animal fur is well and truly out of fashion.
Thank you. The Honourable Mark Latham.
Thank you, Mr. Assistant President. One Nation will be opposing this motion according to the great Australian principle of who cares? Who cares? Because I can honestly say in my nearly 59 years on the planet, not once have I woken up in the morning and thought, what's the Queen wearing today? And as a proud, long-standing Republican, I've got to say, I don't take many role models out of the royal family. We should allow people to have their choices. Now, the paradox in the left using the royal family as their role model...
Order, there's too much chatter in the House.
Indigenous Australian wants to practice their traditional culture of killing an animal and taking the skins and wearing them, as they often do at the opening of our parliaments, is something that should be allowed in a free society. Those furs are part of the Indigenous culture, so it's a case of where identity worlds collide. So too, we've always got to put greater priority on humans ahead of animals. We've heard enough about pigs and rabbits and horses and dogs. Let's turn the focus to sensible debate about the needs of human beings. The human beings who, in the traditions, set these parliaments up to further our civilisation and the people in our society and to treat the natural world fairly but not be obsessed by it.
Further speakers, the Honourable Mark Pearson.
Thank you, Mr. Assistant President. I find it quite extraordinary to hear the words from Mark Latham, who keeps talking about the Westminster system. We wouldn't be in this place if it wasn't for the system that's been built around the monarchy. And the Queen, when she comes, sits behind the Assistant President. The standards that have come for animal protection as well as human protection have often come from statements from the royal family. Queen Victoria was the first queen or regal standing person in the world to adopt and support the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, the first in the world, which was introduced in Parliament by Humanity Dick or Richard Martin. Within 5 years, Queen Victoria enshrined the Society for the Protection of Animal Cruelty as royal. The Queen made it clear that she would not tolerate bear fur being used for the hats of the soldiers in front of Buckingham Palace. The royal family, or the royalty, has actually sent a clear message of a very clear message of a new understanding of what is ethical consideration, that the circle of compassion, the circle of consideration, does not stop at one species. It does not stop at one type of human being. We have to consider mentally ill people, disabled people, the people who cannot stand up and seek assistance for themselves, just like animals. So out of this place actually being established in the principles of the Westminster system, this clearly means we look to our leaders, even in royalty, to shine the way into a much more civilised society. And as Mahatma Gandhi, we can even go to the other side of the world, which was colonised by Britain, England, he said very clearly, and it's often upheld by the greatest thinkers of the world, that the measure of a civilised society is how it treats its animals. If you look after the lowest, you are looking after all. And that is the point I think the Queen has made.
Thank you.
I rise briefly on behalf of the Greens to support this motion. It's important that those viewed as being of importance to some in the fashion world come out and declare that fur is out of fashion. Despite arguably those statements being a couple of decades late, it would have been good to see the Queen do it earlier. I've got no a particular regard or disregard for the Queen, and there was some discussion within the Greens as to whether we should be supporting this congratulation of the Queen. However, on the basis that she is someone that is looked up to in the fashion industry, and that being a queen is also not a requirement, not a necessarily ruling someone out for being congratulated, we decided not to move that amendment. We support the motion. Thank you.
The Labor opposition will not be opposing this motion.
I'll only speak very briefly in reply. The Queen's decision not to wear fur has sent a strong message worldwide, and here in the House, we should not only listen to her message but act upon it by supporting this motion. This House should recognise, as the Queen herself has recognised, that wearing animal fur is cruel and inhumane. It is a real pity to hear members say, "Who cares?" about the murder of millions upon millions of innocent sentient animals for their fur. Who cares about animals being held in cages and slaughtered via anal electrocution or facing a slow death trapped in limb-crushing steel traps is unconscionable. To say who cares about their suffering. Compassion doesn't need to be limited. We don't have to choose between people and animals. We can care about both at the same time. And that's what I would suggest that the member to consider. We all have the ability to feel pain and the ability to suffer. And in that regards, humans are equal to animals.
In fact, we are an animal ourselves. We must acknowledge here today that there is no reason for New South Wales to participate in such a horrendous industry that puts animals through agonising torment and suffering, all for the sake of an item of clothing. Her Majesty's decision is a statement to us all. Animal fur is out of fashion, and we should stand together today congratulating her on her compassionate decision to no longer support the barbaric fur trade.
Thank you. There being 20 ayes and 19 noes, the question is resolved. Aye. In the affirmative. Unlock the doors.
God save the Queen.